Good morning. Welcome to Holy Family. We're glad you're here with us. As we prepare to encounter our Lord Jesus in word and sacrament on the fourth Sunday of Advent, we pray that our worship may not only bring honor and glory to God, but be a source of special blessing for ourselves, our loved ones, and our whole community. My name is Tom Kazanowski, and I will serve as lecturer today. The Mass intention is for Barbara Gear Kennedy. The presider is Father Rich Whitney. We are a faith community of brothers and sisters in Christ, yet we may not always know the names of the people who sit near us each week. And so, before we begin Mass, if you feel comfortable doing so, let's take a moment now to get to know each other better by sharing a name with those around us. And as one family of faith, prepare to worship together.
Please join in singing our gathering song, O Come Emmanuel. If you're using the books at your seats, it's number 39. Please stand.
We gather this morning, as we do all things, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Good morning. Welcome. You may not have seen me before. I'm not around very often. My name's Father Rich Whitney. I belong to Debbie Whitney, who's sitting in the back there, who lives down on Powder Point. And Father Bob is always gracious enough to allow me to come and share the liturgy with you when I'm in town. I belong to the Paulus Fathers, which is a missionary order. I promise I will not ask you for money today. In today's gospel, Joseph receives a dream and realizes the plan of action he thought was right was not what God was asking him to do. So he changed his mind. As we prepare ourselves for these sacred mysteries today, I'd invite us to remember those times that we thought we were smarter than God, but also remembering God's infinite mercy. Lord Jesus, you came to heal the sick. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you came to forgive sinners. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you came to bring light to those in darkness. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech you, O Lord, your grace into our hearts, that we, to whom the incarnation of Christ your Son was made known by the message of an angel, may by his passion and cross be brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask for a sign from the Lord, your God. Let it be deep as the netherworld or as high as the sky." But Ahaz answered, "I will not ask. I will not tempt the Lord." Then Isaiah said, "Listen, O house of David. Is it not enough for you to weary people? Must you also weary my God? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you this sign. The virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel, the word of the Lord." Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Paul, a slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised previously through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, the gospel about his Son, descended from David according to the flesh, but established as Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness, through resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him we have received the grace of apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the Gentiles, among whom you are also, who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all the beloved of God in Rome, called to be holy. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph, of the house of David, and the Virgin Mary's name was Mary. Let's try that again with the actual gospel this time. This is what happens when you get new priests. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. When his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found with child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her to shame, decided to divorce her quietly. Such was his intention when, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife into your home, for it is through the Holy Spirit that this child has been conceived to her. She will bear a son, and you will name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took his wife into his home. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So once upon a time, there was a priest who lived in a very religious town. And this priest wasn't like Father Bob or any other priest you may have met. This priest was not very good. And so one day he woke up on Sunday and looked out the window and saw that it was a beautiful day and decided it was far too pretty to preside over a whole bunch of masses. And so he called his assistant and said, "Father assistant, I'm sick today. Go take care of the masses." And so while the assistant was taking care of the masses, this priest went off to the golf course and set up this first tee, par 5. Boom, eagle. Second, par 4, boom, birdie. Wow, this is astonishing. What's going on here? Third hole, par three, hole in one. This is just a stellar round of golf. And Angel Gabriel is watching this from heaven and getting more confused and irritated as time goes by, and finally gets fed up and turns to God and said, "What's going on here? Why are you letting this happen?" And God just smiled sweetly and said, "Who's he going to boast to?" So angels are really busy this time of year. Angels seem to have consistently one line whenever they appear to us, and it's almost always, "Don't be afraid." This tells me that angels have to be absolutely terrifying. And this is kind of hard for us to wrap our heads around. What are angels all about? When Thomas Aquinas was trying to create a coherent metaphysics to understand and explain angels, he found the only way that he could make his system consistent was if each angel, each individual angel, was its own species, as different from us as giraffes and dogs, perhaps. Aquinas went on to envision 9 categories of angels portrayed in 3 groups called choirs. And you've probably heard these. You're going to hear some of these names later on in this Mass. At the top, you've got seraphim, cherubim, thrones. The next group is dominions, virtues, and powers. And finally, principalities, archangels, and angels. So interestingly enough, as humans, we're only interacting with the lowest 2 orders of angels. And we know some of the names, but very, very few. Michael, Raphael, Gabriel are the most prominent, probably. You might have heard of Ariel, although that's much more of the late rabbinical tradition. And we see Ariel popping up quite a bit in the Eastern Church and in the Anglican tradition. There are quite a few unnamed angels that pepper throughout the Gospels and through the Old Testament, too. The angels who met Lot, the ones who took care of Elijah, and the angels who guided John of Patmos through his apocalyptic revelation. Now, angels have multiple roles, but for us, the most important is probably that of messenger. Angels tell us things from God. Sometimes they do this overtly, like what was going to happen in the wrong gospel that I was reading just a moment ago. You can always tell when the live stream is happening, can't you? So when Angel Gabriel tells Mary that she's blessed, definitely that's an overt sighting of an angel. Sometimes it's more subtle, like in today's proper gospel of Joseph having the dream. Now it's important to remember that angels serve as messengers. They don't command, they don't demand, they ask. They pass the message. God gifting us with free will is absolutely remarkable. And if I were God, it's something that I would have regretted time and again over the centuries. I was not consulted. And this is apparently something that's very important to God, the idea of free will. How important? Well, St. Augustine in the 4th century spent a lot of time and wrote quite a few homilies on this. And he wrote this: "God, who created you without you, will not save you without you. Salvation requires our cooperation. We need to be saved. God has given us free will, freedom to love him, freedom to obey him, and freedom to be with him." We see this reflected in Joseph's actions today. Joseph has a number of choices available to him. He's a good man, and he knows full well what can happen to young women who show up pregnant, and he doesn't want any harm to come to Mary, so he decides to try to keep it quiet. But when the angel points out that he's seeing an important part of his faith system, a prophecy that's about to be fulfilled, he realizes that God may have plans that are beyond his comprehension. And so he agrees. After I moved back to the Boston area in the early 2000s, I started trying to do everything I could to keep me here. I studied addictions counseling. I started working in that field. I started getting certifications to make it easier for me to find work to stay in this area. I love New England. This is home. and left to my own devices because I am an incorrigible homebody, I would never travel more than 30 miles from my house given my choice. Let's be honest, this is not a body that fits well into airplanes. Who needs it? So you can imagine my surprise when I found myself talking to a missionary order of all things. To give you an idea, last summer I clocked about 2,000 miles driving in June. And then, after I got back, I flew to Albany for another conference. I left Knoxville, Tennessee, where I'm assigned right now, on Monday. I will get back there on Wednesday. A week later, I'll be in St. Louis for a week, and then I go back to Knoxville, only a week later to go back to DC. This is my life as a missionary now. I was perfectly happy the way things were, but in some way that I don't entirely understand, I had a visitation inviting me to expand my world. And it's been phenomenal. I'm not alone. In our seminary, we have a medical doctor, a guy with a PhD in cancer biology, a lawyer, a special ed high school teacher, among others. Their lives were fine, but they listened when God sent a message inviting them to more. I have this feeling that angels and signs are all around us, all the time. The question is, how much are we paying attention? How often are we not distracted by the noise of the world? How many burning bushes do you think Moses had to walk by before he said, "Whoa, that looks kind of weird. Let me go see what's up behind that." That's the observation that changed his life. So what about our lives? One of the beautiful aspects of Advent is it gives us permission in our over-programmed lives to find new ways to listen to God and God's angels. And we still have a full week left. Can we learn a new prayer or a new style of prayer? Go to a penance service? Take some time with our families over dinner, some extra time, more regularly? Take a few minutes to discern where are our gifts and how could I volunteer maybe and share them with the rest of the world more valuable ways? All these things can lead us to a better connection with God and a better chance then of hearing God's invitations. God created all of us with the means to make great goodness if we so desire and if we hear that invitation, urging us onward just like Mary and Joseph. Are we listening to those angels? Would we even know them if we heard? As people of faith, we rise and share our common creed. I believe in one God.
The Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, God not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was he founded by the Virgin Mary, he became man. For our sake, he was crucified and Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
With confidence that our loving God cares for us, we offer him our needs and petitions.
For the church, that like Joseph, our hearts may be open and cooperative with the work of God, even when we don't understand how it will unfold. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace, that the coming of the Prince of Peace may bring healing, restoration, and an end to war, violence, and division in our world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are busily preparing for Christmas, that the Holy Spirit will help us to stay aware of whose life we celebrate and to show Christ's love in all our interactions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who will be traveling this week, that their journeys may be safe and their visits with friends and loved ones be renewing and blessed. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, that they may see God face to face, especially at this Mass for Barbara Gear Kennedy. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the petitions received on our parish prayer line, and for the personal needs and intentions we offer in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, graciously hear and answer our prayers which we make through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, O Lord, sanctify these gifts laid upon your altar, just as he filled with his power the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For all the oracles of the prophets foretold him, the Virgin Mother longed for him with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist sang of his coming and proclaimed his presence when he came. It is by his gift that already we rejoice at the mystery of his nativity, so that he may find us watchful in prayer and exultant in his praise. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Rightly gives you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people that you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. And to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom,
power, glory, are yours,
now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a COVIDly appropriate sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be saved. In the body and blood of Christ, keep us safe for eternity. Let us pray. Having received this pledge of eternal redemption, we pray, Almighty God, that as the feast day of our salvation draws ever nearer, so we may press forward all the more eagerly to the worthy celebration of the mystery of your Son's Nativity, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Just a couple of quick announcements. Last opportunity to go to confession before Christmas is this Tuesday from 6:30 to 8 p.m. in the Reconciliation Room and the Chapel. There will be no confessions next Saturday, which is Christmas Eve. And the one collection taken up at all the Christmas Masses next weekend will be for the health and retirement needs of the priests of this archdiocese. Your special generosity is greatly appreciated. Members of our Appalachia Service Project team are selling raffle tickets after Mass today in the front and the side entrances, and four lucky families will receive a reserved pew and two parking spaces on Christmas Mass of their choice, proceeds going towards the service trip this summer. Since I am a missionary disciple, and since most of our places are inner cities, Paulists salivate at the thought of parking lots. It's just do we get excited. You can park here and two free parking spaces. That's beyond price. And we ask that you please pray for the repose of the soul of Richard C. Cox, whose funeral Mass will take place here on Tuesday at 11 a.m. As always, it's a real joy to come home and to be here and share the liturgy with you. Many thanks to Father Bob. Many thanks to our musicians. When you sound that good, I don't have to do anything. We love that. Merry Christmas to you all, and I hope you have a wonderful new year. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May God Almighty bless you abundantly, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass has ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord with your lives.